he left mascara on my thing at the office and it wouldn't come out. So.
Oh, that's somebody. I don't wear mascara.
Good evening. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
What's everybody doing? I have to give myself one of those. I don't think I did.
I think you're doing just. You got the technique.
Look, I hug you.
That's the best hug there. See.
Thank you, brother. Before we get into the meat of today, I just want to. Who was on here last time? Good. So we got enough people. Where everybody? So. One, two, three. Okay, good. So, for me, I need to know what you retained from last time. So we could start here.
Well, one of the things that was really important to me is about the holding on to emotions, holding on to things, because that is something that I know I've been doing, and actually I've been doing, going through a process right now with Nubia, and it's really helping to release some of those things. But I understand now the importance of all this stuff from the past that I was just holding inside. Some of it, it's like, how do I even remember some of these things, you know, things that I was embarrassed of or things that I felt bad about.
That's a key word right there, remember that, embarrassed.
Other people would have forgotten this stuff and gone on. I mean, I'm thinking this morning something came to me like when I was about 4 or 5 years old.
Wow.
That's really ill. So, but my thing is that I'm grateful that I understand the importance of working with that. Mm-hmm. I had known something before I started talking to you, but you validated it and clarified it. Mm-hmm. And so I really appreciate that.
Okay. What? I didn't hear.
Sharing what we retained from last time so we can have a platform to piggyback off of.
Okay.
We'll come back.
Okay, thank you.
It's my first time here.
Oh, she didn't make it. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Well, same thing that Bertha said was the retaining of the emotions, particularly the
the feelings or the emotions?
Say that one more
time.
The
feelings or the emotions?
Yes. Let's go with both of them. Yeah, I would say both of them because emotions can, you know, feed into feelings and vice versa. But in terms of also, what is it, the five big dogs that you really got to watch out for in terms of cancer, what was it, anger, resentment, fear, hatred, and I always forget what the fifth one is.
Right? Anger, hatred, resentment, bitterness.
Bitterness.
Unforgiveness.
Unforgiveness. Yeah. So those were the big ones
That
I've really been, that kind of struck me to kind of pay attention to when those things are coming up.
Right, so you just won't have to deal with cancer.
No, just so they don't come up, hopefully. You don't want them coming up.
The one thing that I remember was what you were talking about, the side of the face and where it is that we carry stress based off of like family relationships or mother father issues and things like that, and how does it certain people will have like either an eye twitch or more wrinkles on the face on this side, or you know, causing the stress on that side of the face based off of that relationship.
Right. So what side of the face is what?
The female side was the left side, male side was the right side.
And you can make a determination which person has an unresolved issue with which parent by looking where?
I want to say it was at the eyes, right on the side. Right, yes.
Right. Absolutely. So you already know who you're dealing with when you're talking to them. So if you see you need to tap into that female side of you and let her come out, because you see that other side is not there. And if it's the reverse, then you do the other. You become more dominant when you talk to them. That way you can have a clear stream of connection going on.
Yeah, well, the most impressive thing that came out for me was the notion of releasing, releasing all those built up stuff that you've created, you know, like against someone else, and probably not yourself so much, but being able to release from that and keep a perspective, you know, like for your own self, so that you don't get caught up in somebody else's emotions, this kind of thing. That's number one. See, number two,
I like that one, getting caught up in somebody else's emotions.
Right.
And the reason I say that is that because we as a melanin-dominant people, we didn't necessarily experience slavery. But we still holding on to the emotions of our great, you know what I'm saying? So, absolutely. Yeah, and now is the time to.
Yeah, let it go. Yeah,
but go ahead.
Difficult as it may be.
I'm going to show you a technique the other day.
Particularly if you read your history,
yeah,
and you go back and see the atrocious things, you know, that occurred, you know, for our people, you know, and still, you know, right to this day, same things are happening. But, okay, that's one part of it.
I can have fun with that one, but go ahead.
The other thing that that was really, really significant in my mind was how the relationship, you know, to one of your organs connect with the other. And they have a consequence, you know, just based on your life, what you do,
mm-hmm.
and what you think, what you eat, all this kind of stuff. And so the connectivity there, you know, was significant, extremely significant.
Yeah, I think we used to sing the song, the rib bone connected to the, but we had a song about it, but there's a consciousness that goes along with it as well.
Absolutely, yeah.
Well, you already shared your testimony. But if you got something else,
no, I'll testimony. No, I'm good.
Well, I pretty much said what I had to do again with the emotions, but one thing I wanted to add, it seems like as I'm forgiving and moving on and getting rid of that stuff, there's still new stuff that comes, and it's like, okay, now how do I begin to get that in a place where that can, I guess, in a way, become consumable in a way so I can be able to get rid of it again? Because right now, I mean, you know, sometimes they can just be overwhelming to get the new emotions or things that you went through where somebody did something and you're starting that build up again. To get that back under control so you can let it
release. Let me get to the core of it.
Get the core of it. And, you know, when you're going through it, it's hard to get through the core of it. I mean, the old stuff, it's already the core. It's just like, well, why do I do that? And, you know, being able to forgive and let that go. But when you're dealing with something new and not trying to hold on to those resentments and things again, it's tough. So you can help with that.
We had some fun today.
Mm-hmm. All right, I missed the last one.
All right, and
that was a great one. Okay.
Back to you.
Yeah. I'm ready now. One thing I want to comment on, it was from a long time ago when you had mentioned this, but me being the type of person I like to deal with foods, when those emotions are running wild and you're dealing with food, that energy is going into the food. And so that's one thing you want to have your emotions in check and maybe meditate or whatever, if you're in a bad mood or whatever the case may be, to get yourself in position before you deal with the food, because after all, when you're eating that food and then you change that structure based off of your emotions, and if you're fixing food for people, that's in that food and that's interacting with them too, and that's not fair to them. So the more emotionally stable you are, now, because you can eat the best food in the world, but if your psyche is messed up, and then it's not like any good. So that's what I learned from you. So thank you very much.
Since we're talking about emotions and tapping into them, talk about that session we did.
The session we did was you, basically I was laying down just being very relaxed, and you put on different types of music. You were trying to get me to a point of total relaxation. And I thought I was relaxed. Mm-hmm. But I didn't know I was not relaxed until you kept on putting different music on and just different ways that you were, you know, touching the body. And
pause for 1 second. That's a note to remember. The way you want to get the ego out of the way, get the mind out of the way, cannot handle music.
Wow.
Music will take the ego, getting totally out of the way, so now it's just your body and spirit is ready for the work. But the monkey mind, the ego, he's always going to be present. But music takes him totally and neutralizes it. And so that's why I play a different, yeah.
Yeah. And so you were able to press on my certain parts of my body, and you said you're tight. But then so you switched up the music, and I think the smell too. You know, so
well, yeah, I was using different oils for each chakra system because all of the organs are attached to different energy centers that we call chakras. And so just reading the body.
But once you put that music on and you put the right tune on, I was gone. I was gone. And then you also said, like, wow, you know, now you're to the point to where I could work with you fully and deep and get into you deep. And so I thought that was, like, amazing. I didn't want to leave. I was ready to stay on that.
Because we were able to work with the whole brain at that point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I'll show you something. Some of you are already doing it right now. And as we get into the actual work, I'll show you a little technique you can do right there that allows you to have full access of your brain. I know they tell us we only use 5% of our brain.
Mm-hmm.
They're eggheads. No, we're using 100% of our brain because what they're looking at is they're looking at the neurons, and they're saying that we 10% of the neurons control the whole brain. Okay, well, they're only saying we're using half of those. But what they're not telling you is that those neurons are only supposed to run at 10% because the rest of the brain is calling the shots for the neurons. So you're actually using the whole. And that science is all coming. The information is coming out about that. So, yeah. But just look at the psychology behind this. If I'm telling people you're only using 10% of your brain, I've already put a cap right there and I got you stuck. Like you're not, no. You're using more than that. Somebody don't want you to know that. Because the most powerful part of the brain that we have is the imagination and the daydreaming. But we've been taught to suppress that and don't do that, or being aloof. But that's when you get full access and you can really do something. I read a piece that I found very interesting. How many of you believe that Thomas Edison really set out to create a light bulb?
No.
What was he doing? What was his intention?
I don't know what his intention was.
It had something to do with energy, right?
Yeah.
Electricity.
Earth charming and energy.
His daydream was all he wanted to do was light up the sky at nighttime. He didn't know how to do it. He wanted to bring light at dark time in the night. And then it trickled all the way down to a light bulb. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was Bob Proctor shared that with us. That was interesting.
Oh.
Yeah, yeah. That was Thomas. Now, how he know that was Thomas Edison's daycare? I don't know. He was there with him. But I can see that. And that was the imagination, how broad.
It was a broad.
An expansive imagination. His imagination was around. He wanted to light up the city at night because it was all dark.
Mm-hmm.
So, when it comes to the mind, let it go. And see where let it just go wherever it needs to go because there's something there for you. Because, and I'll give you an example, then I'll come back over to you. In 1989, I was in Ohio, and I had started this journey, and I was like, I wanted to bring all of these modalities together, holistic modalities, and that's holistic with a W. Some of my people use the H. When did I ever
come? What's the difference?
The word whole versus the word whole. W-H-O-L-E versus H-O-L-E.
I'm thinking about it. I'm thinking
spelled.
No, I'm thinking holistically, so I wasn't thinking about whole. See, when my student is whole,
yeah, you're right.
I get to that part.
That's the twistedness of the English language.
And so here I am looking at all of this, and I have this Pac-Man appetite for this, so I'm studying everything. I'm studying everything from feet to hands, the eyes, the ears, and urine therapy. You know, when I finished, it was like 41 different certain countries. And I was just working with in a holistic community. But I had that thought in 89 that it was something that was really a passion that I was really drawn to. My buddy, which I didn't know at the time, in 1989, on this side of the country, here in California, he's like, look, I'm going to get the insurance companies and medical working together to embrace all of these holistic modalities. Now, he started in 89 with that same train of thought, the same time I did. We were just talking one day and came over the same year. We had the same idea, but on different ends of the spectrum. And so at present, he decided he went back to school about 5-6 months ago. He has about another 7 months ago to go. And then we no longer need a doctor to do what we need to do.
Mm-hmm.
I'm on film, right?
Yes.
No, because he will have his final degree, because he's already been a hospital administrator. He already have all of these degrees for pain management, mental health, and drug addiction. That's his background. But now he had to go back for like 13 more months to get this one other piece of paper so he can write prescriptions. Mm-hmm. Once that happens, we don't need doctors. And insurance companies say, all we need is somebody that can write the scripts and we can make it happen. So we'll be able to bridge those two worlds together where you can come in and see different holistic practitioners, and we have medical, we have a position to sign off on it. Because that's the only problem. That's why I won't work in the medical, in the insurance industry. No medical doctor wants to sign off on holistic modalities. Mm-hmm. And we had one, and then she was a little weird because she was under watch, and and they want to change my protocols. No, you can't change the protocol, just sign off on it. So I need you to sign off on it. Have you ever worked on cancer? No. Then why would you change my protocol? Anyway, that's happening, but that we had that train of thought at the same time. It hit us on the opposite side of the country. We wanted to link it up. And so through I guess we had what I call a date with destiny, as Tony Robbins talked about, and we met, and then the light bulbs came on, and then we just started for the last 4 years to pull it all together. So we're about 6 months, 7 months away from having it all done. Done. Wow. So, you know, imagination is powerful.
Yes, it is.
Am I done with that? What's wrong with that?
Hmm?
I thought that was it. Yeah. Okay, Roxy, your turn.
Well, I kind of have to piggyback on what Lee was saying about how the things that you think, the things that you do affect the organs in your body. And after your session, it was kind of confirming something that I already knew, but I look at women that I know that have had breast cancer. And so many of them deal with unforgiveness of the heart. And I think about members of my family that have dealt with cancer. And most of them, I speak with women and they can be divorced from this man 40 years and still carry that anger. And it affects you. It affects your body.
Yeah. Because it's energy in motion.
Yeah.
And whatever feeling you attach to it, if you inappropriately do it, it's going to anger in there and create a problem. Howard? Or where'd you sleep?
I was carrying stuff, and I could just even now I could think of what that might happen 6 months ago, but I'm still thinking about it.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, it got to where I let go. So that's what I got from it.
Thank you.
Johnny, that was good. Waking up. Yeah, he was pretty quick on me. Sure. Johnny, can you share about some of the books that you, when I was in your office, that you had, The Message of the Body? Those two books were excellent.
Messages from the Body. There's some scholars out there that have really did the work in understanding the mind-body connection and how we inappropriately deal with our feelings and emotions, and they came up with some really dynamite books. That's one. I can't tell you the author's name, so as long as I've had it, but...
You know, I
looked
up on my phone.
Well, yeah, okay, good. And then the other one that I love, it's called Feelings Buried Alive Never Die by Carol Truber.
Excellent.
Excellent
book.
Yeah, yeah. Those are my Bibles. Those are my Bibles.
Feelings Never Die?
Yeah, Feelings Buried Alive Never Die. Some of us, we can do the Torah, or we can read the Quran, or we can do King James, but those are my Bibles right there. Understanding this guy right here, because when you understand this, you can read the Quran, the Torah, and you can see it, the esoteric principles all the way through it. And you're like, whoa, I never even looked at it from that perspective, because it's all about you. But they put it in a code for you not to understand it, because they want to keep you at a certain level of consciousness. So, you know, the power is understanding who you are. So, yeah, was it another one? Oh, and then
astrology.
Yeah, I was about to say. Jed Spiller. I've had like probably about 14 of those books just disappear over the years. And I have to keep buying them, you know. I think I had to buy another one after you left, Bobby.
I was tempted. I wanted to.
Jed Spiller talks about the importance of understanding the North Node. You know, when we learn in astrology, you know, our sun sign, our rising sign, or where our moon is. But guess what? The real knowledge is where that North Node is. Because that North Node talks about the attributes and the gift the Creator gave you to bring here to develop. And it shows you the challenging aspects of who you are that you need to leave behind. Because they no longer serve you this time.
Can you explain what the North Node is?
It's just so it's not a planet. We have a north node and a south node. I can show you what it looks like. Why do they call it a node? I don't know why they call it a node. It's an energy.
Okay.
It's an energy, and it looks like an upside down horseshoe. Actually, a horseshoe with a curl on the end. That's what the nodes. And so you have a south node and a north node. And so the north node talks about all those different attributes that you came here, those gifts you brought to the planet, and how you need to develop them. And this is one of the things that I'm working with a couple other people to create the system for us, because if a mother or father knows exactly, you know, when that child is born, and they can look at the North Node, then they can put exactly the things around that child for that child to naturally evolve into what they came here to do. They won't have to wait till they're 30 and 40 and 50 and go, oh, I didn't have to do this, I could have, yeah. And you can't, I mean, God didn't give us enough sense to outsmart ourselves. So you can't look at what you're supposed to be leaving behind and say, well, no, that's not me. Because you shouldn't see it. It's a mirror. Right, Bobby?
Right.
Did I just see that? You was just trying to hurry up and get on the table. But yeah, that's a very powerful book. It's Jan Spiller. Astrology for the Soul. That's the name of the book. She has two books, but Astrology for the Soul. It's an old book, but it's powerful. Yeah. So those are three dynamite tools to have in your toy chest, your toolbox, to really support you in understanding you. Any questions before I move on? Or comments? Okay, so let me start today's workshop. And the reason I'm saying this workshop is it's hands-on today. You know, we did talking. We don't always do talking, but today we're going to make it practical. And I'll start with a client that they just brought in to see me 2 weeks ago. He came in 2 years ago. His mom, she's the dominant energy in the family. I understand why, after looking into her saliva and looking at her mother's. And, oh, yeah, I see what side of the family that male energy is totally, okay? Which the Bible calls those generational curses.
Oh, yeah.
I call them unresolved emotional issues, that if you don't deal with it, get passed to the next generation and the next generation and the next generation. Mm-hmm. So,
in your understanding, then, this isn't like a curse imposed by a higher being, but it's your own self-perception.
Your perception, and that's what we're going to focus on today, the perception, our perception around all of this. Because, I'm going to do a side note on that.
Sure, yeah.
And I know we probably come from a diverse, maybe, religious background. I'm speaking religiously now. But what creature did the Creator create that he gave a free will to? Anything else? Any other creation?
No.
So how then can we entertain the thought process that the Creator created an angel that could go against him?
He did.
He didn't. So now when you have to go, so wait a minute, okay, you're right. Wait, so what happened? So when the purpose for a thing is unknown, abuse is inevitable. So when you don't understand the purpose of this person that we call Lucifer, then now you're abusing that energy.
Right.
Or you allow that energy to abuse you. Mm-hmm. As we go forward, if you're comfortable, some of you have your legs crossed, some of you have your feet crossed, some of you have your hands crossed, arms crossed. That's great. That's great, because what happens is that your shoestrings don't count power. You have to cross your hands. When you have a crossing, you access full aspects of the whole brain.
Okay? That's good to know.
Yes. This is why in Tai Chi, when we're doing our work, we're constantly going left brain, left hemisphere, right. So when
got your eye.
You got full access to your brain. You're holistically present in that moment. So because I'm going to download some good stuff, I want you to have all of it. All of it, which means that you're going to logically interpret it, and then you're going to feel it, and then you're going to see it, and then you're going to smell it. And so all senses will pick up from the left and the right hemisphere of your brain. Okay. All right. So when they brought Joe in 2 years ago, because I wasn't doing the DNA sampling then, and this is the prelude for our workshop.
Is this an adult or a child?
Adult. He was 32. Mom just wanted him to come in, and basically she really wanted me to tell him to get his life together, all right, to line up to where she wanted. Thank you. Because, you know, Joe was doing what he wanted to do. I mean, he had a good, great job. He wasn't out there like that, but he just was eating whatever he wanted to eat, and she wanted him to be vegan at 32. This guy was doing Carl Jr. She's like, look, I'm eating the best. Not Carl Jr.'s. What is that other place that got Jack in the Box? No. The other place that's supposed to have the best French fries out of everybody.
Oh, no. In-N-Out.
Yes.
In-N-Out.
In-N-Out. That's what he was killing. In-N-Out.
As soon as you said French fries,
In-N-Out's supposed to have the best potato, the best. Yeah.
Sure. I didn't know that.
Yeah. That'll make you feel about it. So that was pretty much Joe's diet, in and out and stuff like that. So I just did iridology and I looked and I saw, okay, he's 34, blah, blah, blah. But I just saw a lot of what we call radii solaris. Anybody that understands this, iridology? Radii solaris is where you see like a spoke, like a bicycle spoke, and it just moves throughout different parts of the iris. Well, he had some all over. And in this, you know, I said, well, we just need to go in and do a detox, clean his bowels up, and let's get rid of some parasites. So they, okay, right, whatever. Still went and did what they wanted to do. 2 years ago. 2 weeks ago, she says, I want to bring Joe in to see you again. He has this, some disease these doctors came up with. I don't get caught up in diseases because all they do is look at symptoms and they attach a name to it. And if they don't have one, they make up another one or they name it after a doctor. So I said, yeah, just bring him in on Monday. Or is it Tuesday? Tuesday. So they get there. I see the they have a big SUV. I see the SUV pull up and I see her jump out, but I don't see Joe. And so I'm waiting for him. He comes in on a walker.
Still in his 30s?
34 now, comes in on a walker with this degenerative disease that's causing him to become paralyzed. His joints are crystallizing. He has very little to no motion in his neck. His right knee is frozen. The left knee is freezing. The muscles are constricted and he cannot move but like this. And so they want to put him on methotrexate. And say it'll slow down his degeneration process. Well, I'm that guy, and I don't care what disease you have, I know that there's an unresolved emotion that we inappropriately dealt with that triggered the problem. Now, just looking at his being, I already knew that it was foundational. So we did the saliva, got the results back. His body was loaded with viruses and parasites. Viruses in the joints, parasites moving throughout the muscles. Their waste product created an acidosis through his body, where his whole body was acidic. So now the muscles are atrophying because there's no alkalinity there. It's just all acid. So he's, and they wanted to go in and infuse his spine, so that something weird. You know, so me understand. I watch this. She'll probably never see this. Because I know his mother. And so I'm waiting to get that saliva back because we do an emotional profile on everybody. And I wanted to look at those emotions because I already knew it was foundational and I was going to be like, see, this is you. You helped create this, right? And when I got it back, lo and behold, female. It said source of disharmony, female, unresolved issues with the female, family, early childhood. All right then, right? So I'm going over the results with the parents, and mom wanted to say, oh, this came through his dad's side of the family because they're divorced. No. Female. Here's the interesting part. Mom gave birth to Joe when she was 19 while she was in medical school. She wanted to finish and get her medical degree. Guess who babysat? Grandma. Guess who was the driving force? The female male, literally. Grandma. What did grandma do? She stripped every ounce of masculinity out of that little boy, and he grew up for 30 years afraid to embrace who he was because of what grandma said and did to him and over him. So, he had an ulcer 20 years ago. Okay? Ulcers, lawyer's stomach. All that talks about and tells me is that a person is trying to stomach something that's very acidic to them. Okay? So for all these years, he tried to stomach that emotion. He never told what grandma did or said to him. So then it went from stomaching that emotional toxicity to now he created the parasites that was eating away at him. Something on the inside eating away at you every day and night. The moment you start allowing things to eat away at you mentally or emotionally, you're going to create the perfect breeding ground for the parasites to come in and start nibbling away. Something eating me up on the inside. And that's what was happening with him. And so when I was so happy to say, yeah, Ma, this came from the female. And she was like, no, that was my mom. And then it gave him an opportunity. 30-some years later, he says to Mom, she did terrible things to me. He never expressed it to anybody. He held it all in. He was the eldest. He is the eldest out of all of the siblings. He just held it together and kept being the provider, looking out for all the other siblings, and just stomached it. But at the same time, so afraid of expressing what happened, allowed it to eat him up, and he totally did not want any type of female connection at all. 35, virgin. Mom's like, I need you to help him. Yeah, everything is normal. You would never know anything is wrong, except for the condition. But he's never had an intimate conversation with a girl, ever. Wow. Because from a little boy, he was shut down. So all this came up in the saliva. So I got the flower essences that we need to go in and start to relieve that emotion. And so I told him I needed to... They'll never see this. I said, I need to see him body work on him at least twice a week, but I am doing body work on him, but I'm actually going in there unleaking, triggering and releasing some of that emotional stuff. Because until that emotional stuff is released, his body will still hold it. Mm-hmm. And so I wasn't sure on If I was to say, oh, I just want to do emotional work with him, I wasn't sure that he was mentally understanding that to want to do that as well as a family. So when I put it on the physical, they were like, yeah, let's do it. Right. We want him walking again. But I'm still working on the walking. After 2 weeks now, he has more motion in his neck, and he's moving faster, and he actually went to the bathroom at my office. Then that was just after two sessions. But the point of all of that is that those unresolved feelings that we suppress from childhood on creates all of the things that we experience as adults. Also, it has everything to do with who we attract in our life. Everything who we attract in our life. Our whole thought process around relating to men and women is based on a filter, an emotional filter or matrix that's put in place by mom during that third trimester. Whatever emotional things that she's dealing with or not sets the tone for that little one. And then when the child is born, it steps right into that reality. You're right. And then, so the actual soul that's in that body never really 100% gets to come forward in its full fruition because it's living through the filters of what mom was going through. This is why in some of the Japanese cultures and Chinese more so, when a woman is pregnant, they pull her out of circulation. She's off somewhere where it's just nothing but flowers and nature and calmness because they understand the importance of her having homeostasis and emotional equilibrium while she's carrying that child. They're not allowing her to watch Freddy Krueger.
Right.
I'm not allowing her to watch CNN.
That's true. Transferred to the child. Your mother's emotions, how is that translated to the child?
Mother? Any mother. Nervous system.
Well, they're kind of
the same.
Any woman.
It's the same body.
Yeah.
I get that, but I mean, like, there's a medium, you know, it has to go through in order for that child to perceive, you know, that the mother's actually expressing.
The child is not perceiving. He's not at the age to perceive. He's just feeling all the way till he's about 5 years old.
So, but that comes to him how?
The physical.
In other words, how he is acting as a result of his mother's experience.
I'll take it from this perspective. In iridology, the first thing that we discover is that in a fetus, the brain is formed. From the brain, there's an eye, which is an extension of the brain. This is why we can look in the eye and see the whole body. The next part of the body is the gut, which we call colon material. And then from the gut, your liver, your heart, everything else buds. But prior to that gut material being formed, you have what we call an limbic system that starts to develop, which is the system around your emotions. Mm-hmm. And her emotional state sets the tone.
So that's just transferred through like an energetic emotional state from mom to child.
Yes, that's why it's very important for mom to be good when she's pregnant.
Okay, I get it.
If mom got stuff going on, guess what?
Yeah.
I'm going to give you another example on that. I think I shared this before, but this was a good one. I was a part of an integrative team back home, and there was a six-month-old baby that with liver cancer. Mm-hmm. They knew they couldn't give the baby anything because all the medicines would cause a problem with the liver. So we were doing a roundtable conference call trying to discover, okay, what can we do for this child? So one of the doctors from Cleveland Clinic, I think he's like, well, what does the holistic corner want to say on this one? He's like, okay, good. I always let them talk it out because they get nowhere. You know what I was doing? They get nowhere because when they can't use medicine, they're stuck.
Right.
And they can't go in and cut the liver out of a six-month-old baby. So it was real simple. I said, first of all, you got to get mom and dad on the phone because what the baby is, the manifesting is a combination of what was going on with mom. In fact, it was liver. I already know it was a bunch of anger involved. So they got mom and dad on the phone. Mom and dad, they were still living together. And basically, in a nutshell, the same time, while mom was pregnant, dad slapped mom didn't want to be with her and left her. So she got all of this anger and resentment towards dad. So that third trimester, that baby is feeling all of this anger that mom got towards dad and rejection. Okay?
Yeah.
So then the baby is born, and now the baby shows up, and it's 6 months here, and it's like, oh, with liver cancer. I'm like, oh, where'd this come from? So what I told him to do, you can't give the baby anything, so just take some garlic and chop it up. Have him chop it up and mince it up with castor oil. And put a pack over the baby's liver, put it at the baby's, at the bottom of the baby's feet. Now what we have to do, because there's always, remember I was telling you, there's always an invisible umbilical cord that's still attached to that child. Okay? Based on mom, what's happening with mom. So what I did, I said, we got to get those two together, and they got to resolve this. And in a nutshell, when they dad came back home, and then the cancer went away.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Hence the curse that comes down from one generation to the next. It's just that, which you just explained to me. In other words, the connection between the parent relative to the energy, you know, that's going on within them and her and him.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually transfer the illness or the effect to that child. Hence, the curse is something that they've created, not something that comes from the creative source.
Aren't we co-creators?
Of course.
We've been given the ability to create things, right?
That's what I'm
saying. So when the purpose for a thing is unknown, we typically abuse it before we understand how to use it.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So yeah, okay, that's my point.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, today, you're going to learn how to, I'm going to show you how to exercise another part of that, creativity. Outside of you, even though there's no umbilical cord, where are we going to send some energy to? Yeah.
Well, I would say to put one of the perfect examples was during slavery. One thing that they always did, when they took the men out there and strung them to the tree, who do you think they had standing there watching? They had the women.
Right.
Because as long as they could traumatize you, you're traumatizing the baby.
Mm-hmm.
And it's being passed down.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. What was that guy's name? He wrote the papers to keep you a slave.
Willie Lynch.
Willie Lynch papers. That was all science.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. But I wasn't going to go there, but since she went there, we brought slavery back to it. We all know what karma is, right?
Karma. Yes.
Don't anybody got any guns? I don't want nobody to shoot me. Ask yourself, what did we as a people do to have that experience?
I've always asked my students that in class, my students.
What did we do as a people to create that reality?
We push albinos out of our midst, you know what I'm saying?
Look at you. We're not albinos. You remember that?
That's a theory.
Yaku?
I haven't heard that one.
That's because don't nobody want to talk about it. But it's actually what happened in ancient Egypt. We wanted to, that's why genetic engineering and cloning is not new. They were doing it back then. They tried to create a group of people, and the people were too weak. They couldn't stand the sun, the hair was blonde, the eyes were blue, so they took all of the people and ran all of them up to what's called the Caucasus Mountains.
Well, the ones that didn't
want to buy. Well, they couldn't do the work either. So, and we thought once we moved, run them up to where it was cold, that they would die out. But the black gene was in them, so they adapted. Yeah, we adapt anywhere on this planet because we're the rich, you know. And then when they came down with a vengeance.
Hold it on to all of that emotion. You know, that's kind of like Lion King story, but in a different kind of look, you know.
I saw Lion King, but what part?
Well, the fact that they were in exile, and then people are like, well, and then he's so angry. I didn't see the whole thing. Right. This is what I picked
up.
And then this lion that was coming back, well, he's angry because he's been disenfranchised. So when he comes back, of course, he's coming angry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and he's taking no prisoners.
Trying to get his stuff back.
Which there's no prisoners.
Yeah,
I think I heard, as a matter of fact, I know it was certain. I heard Minister Farrakhan talk about that too one day. You talked about how if we want to look at and call something evil, we need to look at the source from which that evil came from. So, which brings us back here. Brings us back home. Yeah. But when we come back home with this level of consciousness, we can totally disconnect from all of that, because guess what? Consciously, we didn't experience that. That was something our ancestors needed to experience. We're here now to create heaven on earth. That's what we're here to do now, especially in this dispensation. But the challenge is, before we can begin to manifest heaven on earth out there, we got to bring it in here. And so, but what are we dealing with right now? We're dealing with fibroids, prostate cancer, diabetes, irregular heartbeat. So we have to bring heaven to this temple first. Then energetically it can flow out. And that's what makes this a very, very interesting time on the planet right now, because now we have all the tools and the science to point all the fingers back to come here and do the work. Because when you do the work here, it automatically manifests out there. And it's not like we need any more information. We have the internet. We have every aspect of all type of knowledge that is, was, and ever comes. Yeah. And now science with, what is that, Scientific America, yeah. The most powerful computer on the planet is us, our brains. And today I'm going to show you what, how that really brain really, really can serve you. And it goes back to this principle. As a man or woman thinketh in his heart, so is he. It goes back to the heart where those neuropeptides are generated. This is logic. This is programs. These are where those emotions come from. And they will override this guy every day.
Yes, it will.
This is why another esoteric teaching, if you look at it right, a house divided against itself can't stand. Or in other words, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Or one individual that's running on emotions here and then intellect over there and emotions over here and the intellect's over there is unstable. Your job is to synchronize the two. And then
I was going to offer that there are snacks back there. People want to get snacks, but how does that interfere with your
shop? No.
It doesn't?
No.
So feel free, but we're going to keep it moving.
Yeah.
If, do we, anybody need like a 10-minute break or anything, or keep it?
No.
No? Okay.
Let's get going.
Okay.
I can eat
with
some same time.
Okay.
At the Nile Valley, I did it for 3 years in a row. Every Thursday night, 65 people in that restaurant for 3 straight years.
Yeah.
Everybody was eating.
Okay.
Chicken.
That's what I remember.
That's what I'm saying.
Oh God! I used to call those because it was a Muslim restaurant. It was the Nile Valley, and so I used to call it the Conversations on the Nile with Jonathan. We had fun. So yeah, as a man thinking in his heart, so is he. And the double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So when we inappropriately deal with these feelings, we start to attach to these emotions. If we don't deal with them properly, it's going to create a disresonance or disease. Period. Now, one of the biggest challenges that I've been seeing is that when we, some of us, create a disresonance or disease, we fall into this energetic mindset of, look what happened to me.
Mm-hmm.
Look what they did to me. Look at what Satan did to me. Satan is attacking my flesh. This is what runs in our family.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Remember this word, epigenetics. Epigenetics. The hottest science out there right now. Understanding that, yes, you have the DNA. Yes, you learned that there's over 30,000 different programs that you can program your genes around your DNA. meaning that you can be born in a family that's full of cancer, and guess what? If you do your work, or you're aware, it won't even come knocking at your door. They've actually even done tests where they took adopted children and put them in a family where there was diabetes or cancer, and then that child became predisposed to it as well, and they were adopted. Why? Because of the conversations and the energy in the house transformed. Actually, I shouldn't say transformed. It placed programs in your subconscious mind. And those programs keep running. Mm-hmm. They keep running. Nonstop. Because of what you heard when you was in that impressionable age. What you felt.
I was just going to add, I mean, I know we talked about generational curses, and yes, that's something that's said, but through my own understanding, I learned that even though there's something that you may be more susceptible to, like high blood pressure and things like that, doesn't mean it has to happen to you. So I saw it as like, you know, I know you're talking about energy and I'm learning more and things like that, but it's choices that you make along your way mm-hmm. that would cause those things to occur or not to
so
occur.
So why do we make those choices? That was the point that I was making over here. Why do we make the choices that we make that creates the conditions that we have?
I think it's lack of understanding at times why we make some of these choices. It's just something that we've been, like we follow like some script or something that's already been there that we don't
the
understand.
Imprint.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The emotional or the imprint that's placed upon our limbic system, at the seat of our emotions. That's how we begin to, you know, let me give you an example. Oh, my mother, they don't fly. They don't go anywhere. They stay right where they, right there in Cleveland. The very first time when I said, okay, I'm out, I'm going to Africa. What? Why are you going to Africa? You shouldn't go over there. It's not safe. I'm going to Alabama. Why? It's not safe. Who's driving with you? You know you fall asleep at the wheel of the car. I'm flying. It's a fear factor.
Yeah.
It's a fear factor. It was for the fear. False evidence appear real. But this is my this is her belief system. This is how see, if I can't support you and expanding your belief system, then you're going to stay exactly where you are because it was your belief system that set you up for what you're experiencing right here and now. Your belief system. You believe you have high blood pressure? You got high blood pressure. What are all the things that come along with it? Oh, well, the diet, this, and this, and all of that, right? Mm-hmm. But what about if we just decide to say, I no longer want to give that thought any energy that I've been holding for the last 15 years. When that energy comes, say, you know what? Thank you. When anger shows up, say thank you. Because they're going to come up. Mm-hmm. And I'm not the guy to say that they're bad. I'm saying understand what they're trying to show you. Because they only come up to show you something. I'm dealing with an individual and anger comes up. Rather than me getting angry and upset with you, I need to back up and say, okay, anger, what are you trying to show me about this dynamic? And 9 times out of 10 has nothing to do with you. It's something you said or emotion you did, or it could even be the fragrance you wear that takes me back to a spot. But it's a trigger for a deeper core wounding.
Trigger for what?
A deeper core wounding. A trigger that triggers a deep core wound is what I should say. Deep core. Okay. Yeah. A core wound, a wound that you had way back here. Have you ever met somebody, every time you connect with them and you go someplace, they say something always happened. Or they always find a fault with somebody at the park. Everywhere you go, they find a fault with somebody.
Yep. Yes.
That's because something happened way back here where they didn't want to accept themselves for who they are, how they're showing up, and so now they have to take that energy and put it on somebody else. Mm-hmm. And then they feel validated. Mm-hmm. I want to show you how this power that we all have. You the president. I'll use you. Go outside. That door's on me. Let me show you. I'm going to have Bobby come back in here. And I'm going to have her sit here. And I'm going to show you the type of power we have. And what I want everybody to do, and some of you may have done this before, if you was in some of these energy classes, I want you to take your right hand and hold it towards Bobby, and I want you to project anger, fear, bitterness, whatever those projected on her, okay? And we're going to watch what she feels. And then we're going to turn it around. Watch this. I work with anybody. I'm going to show you how much power we have to project. Mm-hmm. And then what I'm going to show you before we leave, how to take that same and turn it around to project in different parts of your body. We're co-creators. Exactly. We've just been living beneath our potential body. I believe that.
Yes.
Yeah. You sit here in front of the class. I want you to just relax. I want you to close your eyes. And I want you to breathe. In here. Let those beads go in. Let me know when you relax. Okay. Good. Right hand. Keep breathing, Bobby. Everybody else, take a deep breath. Intensify it. Okay. What's the first feeling that comes to your mind? What do you feel in your body? What do you feel going on in your brain? Good, bad, ugly, whatever. Tell us what that feeling is. And tell the truth.
I feel like, why am I sitting in front of everybody?
Girl, I thought about that when I picked her. I swear I just...
Okay, that's the first feeling. Why am I here? How did I get here?
Okay. Keep going.
Okay.
What do you feel? Light,
I feel
heavy.
Full. I'm saying all the wrong things.
No, this
wrong person. I told you I was relaxed, but I'm not totally relaxed. When you asked me, was I relaxed?
Okay.
So I'm not totally relaxed.
Okay, so what do you feel?
Not relaxed.
And?
What energy do you think? I feel neutral as far as energy. I feel pretty neutral.
Really?
I am. It was too difficult for me to actually try to put that out there.
Okay, y'all get a pass. Go ahead.
Okay.
No, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say that, because somebody else said they're saying it's difficult, but I didn't have the pain in my arm in trying to channel that energy that way, because I internalized myself. Something began to hurt trying to channel what you
right, okay, and it happened with a couple of y'all, right?
Uh-huh.
You felt what?
My stomach started hurting.
Head.
My arm was heavy.
Yeah, my arm's hurting.
Anybody else?
No, I just.
Because I got heat running up and down my spine.
Mm-hmm. I said I feel released. So.
And you go, okay. What?
Yeah, she's just wondering. Sorry.
Oh, go ahead.
It got loud.
It got loud? Mm-hmm. What do you mean?
I don't know why you're
starting. The room got loud. Bobby, what we were doing, it's a little simple technique that I learned a long time ago, how you can project energy. And so I had everybody to attempt to project some form of negativity towards you. And they love you so much that they couldn't do it. So they start feeling pain in their body. I'm gonna take the pain off and just give it to Bobby. Except for me.
Except you started feeling it in your spine, though.
Yeah, you could.
The energy moving.
But you just.
Is that trying to somebody else?
No, it's too late.
Okay. But I was going to say, if the energy will and can from us, because if I'm in a spiritual setting and we're in prayer for someone.
It does.
It definitely
and does. And this is just to make us conscious of the power that we have. That's it. Just like we can project a negative vibe, we can project a positive one. This is what laying on the hands is all about. This is what all of this stuff about Reiki is about. I mean, $10,000 to get a symbol to just be able to.
Yeah.
Don't be mad. I went through it too. I just didn't pay 10 grand. I didn't. I learned it years ago.
I have to say that I just recently was talking to somebody, a friend of mine, and she had gone to a class and paid money for it and all that. And I was like, and she was telling me, she said, well, I didn't get anything out of it. I said, well, how are you going to get something out of it when it's already there? You already have it. So there was nothing for you to get out of it.
Probably one of the greatest.
She knows better.
One of the greatest Reiki masters or energy transfers that I have ever known was my great-grandmother.
You gonna say it was
all she had to do was come over and like, oh, it's gonna be all right. And start rubbing, and the pain go away, and she make you feel better, or come and lay your head in mama's lap, and it's done. Folks making money off of transferring their energy. Okay.
But anyway, why? Because so many people, what? Have no lack of control. They don't say they're
looking outside of themselves.
Yeah. So anybody, you know, I want to get sidetracked, but you had that same thing in Emeryville in 78 when I was in high school,
mm-hmm.
when the guy came from India and people giving their whole house and they lived there and had a whole setup. So you made $300,000, $200,000, $100,000 back then was a lot, but they would give the money to the church, food provided, and they lived within those walls for years. And that guy's still there, you know, another person, but 30 years later, they walk with bodyguards around the street of Oakland, and they did that. And you saw people, like, come up every day, and he would go to the temple, and they would try to get that energy and that charm. But they paid all that money because they couldn't find it within themselves. And someone else had to tell them that you're worthy of. It's already in that temple, but that's money. Like you said, it's people, and people need that, I guess, that balance. Because it's probably harder said than done, and everybody doesn't have the ability to reverse their feelings out and transfer, and I think they hold on to them. But I guess the point where we all need to release that, like you said, because of diseases and,
yeah, there's
internal
there's,
injuries.
There's, there, the Creator has given us, thank you, the Creator has given us, you've been wonderful. The Creator has given us tools to support us in releasing this thing.
Yeah.
Just like we have herbs, for cleansing and rejuvenation, we have the flowers to go in and work on an emotional body. Bach flowers. I like the Australian bush flowers better. To me, they seem to cover more space and they work faster. We have the essential oils that have tremendous healing abilities and because the oil from the flowers has a vibration, and that vibration will energetically align or cause your energy to realign itself. I think that was a study I did looked at out of what university was that? They actually done a test, and I don't know why I even brought this up, but maybe somebody need to hear this. Tano Technologies did this test. Energetically, it takes 3 days to recover from a sip of coffee.
Hmm. I can believe that.
A sip. So what they did, they took the essential oils and did the study, and it where right after the guy sipped it, they had a control group. They sipped it, they allowed the other group to take the 3 days to recoup. This other group, they allowed them to smell the fragrance of essential oils, and within 20 minutes, their energy was better than before.
Does it matter what essential oil?
Well, all essential oils have different vibrations.
Right.
You know, rose oil has the highest vibration, which is about 325 megahertz. And so when I'm doing my work on the table, I'm always working with, well, all of the energy centers, but especially the heart. The reason that I like to work with the heart for multiple reasons, but the heart is the energy center that allows us to connect heaven with earth.
Mm-hmm.
These three lower chakras, earth. And I find that one of the biggest challenges, and most of the clients that's coming in now, because I'm energetically looking at people when they come in, it's a problem with the root or the sacral.
Mm-hmm.
Root of sacral. And so people are, and so what kind of conditions do you have when there's an imbalance with the root or sacral chakra? Anybody know?
And just
keep in mind that, think about the organs in that particular area. So this is your root chakra here, for those that don't know. This is your sacral, this is your solar plexus, this is your heart, this is your throat chakra, pineal, crown. So,
organ problem.
Yes, which one?
Prostate, liver, kidneys, kidneys, uterus,
ovaries, colon,
pancreas.
Men, this is getting ready to be a very teachable moment for us. Since there's a lot of women here.
Prostate, colon.
Yeah. Man, we're about to have a
erectile dysfunction.
That's
the root.
That's
the
root.
Sacral. Yeah.
So, watch this. Man, we're ready to learn something very valuable about women. Ladies, why do you think we develop fibroids, cysts, uterine problems, UTIs? Why?
Lack of creativity. Your creative processes are...
Hurt from where? That too.
Because we didn't get what we wanted, or no lack of love, or lack of what we feel, because lack of love. Mm-hmm.
Dig a little deeper with that.
Being hurt because.
Hurt by who?
Maybe your mate.
Not me.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. Matter of fact, I'm glad you brought that point up.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sitting at my office day before yesterday. She's 24 years old. We're just doing counseling. And she's telling me, because for 13 years, she held this in. She's telling me about how her father's best friend molested her for 2 straight years.
Mm-hmm.
As she was reliving that experience and sharing, she got a tremendous pain in her left hip, right there sitting in the chair to where she bent over. Another one immediately, right like a golf ball, and I felt it, popped up in her right shoulder. And so literally, we had to stop the session, and I had to go in to start doing some body work with oils to do some emotional clearing, because her body was remembering the trauma. Mm.
Right. Reliving it.
Yeah, and now so what was interesting about the left hip and the right shoulder?
When you touch that, maybe the tension, she tightened up at that point when she was being assaulted. I don't know, a combination of, I would say stress.
I don't like stress. I told you last time. Stress,
yeah.
God, the devil, and Ben Laden, they get blamed for stuff they don't have to do with.
Well, the tension, the feelings were in that area. Her body tensed at that point. I would assume that her body tensed, well, your pink tense or whatever. Your shoulders, you're telling people to pull away. She wouldn't want him to sexually assault her, so you would try to protect yourself.
You're trying real hard.
Yeah, that's what I'm getting.
Yeah.
And that's what I would get from her too, Aries. Yeah.
And what did you just say?
I said this is the female side. The male side.
Absolutely.
That's right.
Left hip.
Yeah.
What are the hips and the legs for? Moving forward in life. The pain was stuck in her left hip. The female was scared to go forward in life.
Right.
Because after it happened with the father's best friend, then it happened with the baseball coach. And then after the baseball coach for three years in high school, then it's like, well, I don't care about, I'm not special. So then she became very promiscuous. So as she was reliving it, the pain, this left hip kicked in. Why was the right shoulder? That was the masculine side. She was carrying all of that male toxicity in her shoulder. And it manifested as she started talking about it. So we had to, it took about 2.5 hours. But, you know, I didn't leave the office that day about 11, but we had to get down to it. So when you talk about these relationships and what happened with little girls, when that energetic body called dad and male is not there when that little girl comes out the womb, she's looking for it. Non-stop. Because that's the other part that brings her foundation together. She got mom. Mm-hmm. But she's looking for dad. And so because dad is not there, she has no correlation of what that should look like or feel like. So she picks Tyrone. Oh, he hurt me. Oh, she picks Kenny. Jim, he treated me better than that, so I'll stay with him, even though he's psychologically abusive. He's not beating me like him. And it goes on and on and on until they get to the point in the late 20s, 30s, and then guess what's starting to happen? These tumors. Because all a tumor is just a ball of hurt from somebody that you've been intimate with. Fibroids. Cysts. Just totally pissed off and angry. So a cyst will pop up on an ovary. You're angry because he didn't do something the way you wanted him to do it. I'm not letting him off the hook. I'm talking about how it's very, very important for you to maintain your temple and your energy. Because if you got you together, it doesn't matter what he's doing.
But is there, and it's still a nutritional connection? I mean, we're holistic.
That's garbage.
I mean, I
know I'm being taped, and I used to teach it was nutrition years ago. Come May, it'll be 30 years I've been doing this work. Mm. Garbage. Does it help? Yes.
Okay.
But is it the problem? No.
Okay, that's what I wanted to clarify.
Because I can take you.
Bro, I know visions of
down the south side, over some folks' house. And they eating chitlins, and they eating smoking
Nothing, none of this.
Because they processing their emotions right.
Yeah.
They're not stuffing stuff in. That lady, Miss Hattie, that cuss everybody out in the neighborhood, she will never have a little problem. No, not Miss Hattie.
She doesn't have any stress.
That's why it takes so long.
I'm resting good at night.
Yeah.
Like,
that's my grandmother.
Let me go. Estrogen.
Estrogen is a female hormone, right?
Right.
Okay. Where is it created? In the liver, right?
Right.
Okay. So here it is. Tell me what group of people that's teaching women to celebrate their menstrual cycle. What group of people, what mothers or dads telling their daughters, look, this is the very essence that make you divine feminine. This needs to be celebrated. Now I can bring your nutrition in and say, now if you eat this with exercise, that particular part of your reality will be the way nature intended it to be, which is only about 1 to 2 hours of a cycle. It is only about 1 tablespoon of endometrium lining and a little blood. That's it. Not a 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 14-day period.
Right.
If you just bleed for 14 days, when they do everything, they can't stop it.
Can you say?
And you can bleed. But it's okay for...
No, it's not okay.
If it was me, oh, we'd find a way to
fix that. Now you've tapped into a whole nother level of consciousness, yeah. The patriarch, because guess what? The male ego has been dominating for the last 2,500 plus years.
Yeah, right.
Okay, and the women are taught...
This is happening. Yeah.
But now things is changing because the divine feminine is taking over to put this thing back in balance.
Right.
So now the information is coming to the forefront for this woman to really own the power that she was stripped and mentally, emotionally, physically stripped from.
Yeah.
Generation to generation.
And passed on
to the point you last day.
Yeah.
And then you put on a victim hat. Yeah. And what happens when a person puts on a victim hat?
Everything they have is already
they become a victim, but watch this. Then they look for a savior. They look, victims look for a savior.
Jesus Christ.
Whoever.
I'm saying that.
Howard. That white knight on that horse.
They look for someone to deliver them from their drama.
Right.
And what did the creator say when he said, okay, try it if you want to. Right. Because guess what? You created this, and your spiritual muscle and your consciousness will grow the moment you redo it. You have to reprogram it.
I just love
him. Go ahead.
This movie out right now, even though he's using the sex, he sent down a message if you look past the sex. He said, until you women come together, it's not just going to change.
No. What movie is this?
Shy Rat. But that movie, if you get by him using the sack, because he is giving a message. You look one step deeper, he's telling you the women come together.
Think about the menstrual cycle that's so powerful. Where in the days of ancient, they say the women, they put the women out and didn't want the women to be around there in the cycle. But guess what? Some of those women that were gained conscious, they knew that that was their most powerful time of the month. You do a whole lot of manifestation when it's that time of the month. You have so much creative power to create, to make things manifest. But when you have this thinking virus running through your head that, oh, damn, it's that period, and oh, I hate this time of the month, and oh, I can't do this, and oh, no, your body is hearing every single mumbling word that you're saying. And your genes is picking that up. That 21 strands of or 26 strands of junk DNA they just found out is active. It's waiting for you to command it to do something. And because we don't know we can't command it to do something good, guess what we do? Command something bad. You're gonna command something. It's either gonna be good or bad.
And the body does it.
And the body follows it.
That command, negative or positive, whatever, basically.
When anger shows up, what should you ask? What should the question be? When anger shows up.
Why am I angry? What is the purpose of anger? Where did it come from? Centralizing. Where is the anger coming from? You know, why am I holding on to it? Why am I accepting it?
Just when it, like, let's just say you and I dialogue and now you just get pissed off at me. What should the question be?
What did I do?
What is the purpose of this anger? What are you here to teach me? See, all of these emotions, and I just, when I said bad, I caught myself. Because it's not bad. These emotions are not bad. They're here to show you something. They're your teachers. When anger show up, when fear show up, when disappointment show up, when depression show up, when depression shows up, our pharmaceutical company says, okay, we got something for you. It's called Prozac. Yeah. And we're going to make $240 million every day selling you antidepressants.
Yeah.
Because when depression knocks at your door, you're not aware of why he's knocking. Tell me why you think depression is coming.
You're suppressing yourself. Or are you feeling oppressed?
You're feeling oppressed. It flips out anger. When depression flips out anger,
When depression knocks at your door, what is it doing? What gift is it bringing you? Let me change it around and say that, because they're bringing you a gift.
It's depressing.
And it's depressing you for what?
From joy.
For you to look at.
Freedom.
For you to look at what?
For you to do that.
Whatever the issue that is affecting you.
Depression is suppressing you because there's something that needs to be expressed.
Yeah.
And you're not expressing from your creative center, so depression will continue to press you until you do it. But what we've been conditioned to do is take a drug.
Mm-hmm. We don't allow it to work then. We don't allow it to work naturally for that.
No, because we were never taught to ask ourselves the right question. Why is criticism showing up? Why every time I talk to you, I feel criticized and judged? Why is that coming up? Oh. So when criticism shows up, depending on what side of these kidneys it's going to hit, wait a minute. I'm still holding those critical words that my dad said to me when I was 5, when I was 7. And so now here come criticism showing itself for me to go back and go, I need to dismiss from that energy. I need to let that particular part of disappointment go. Let me let that go. Let me do the work to release that, because if I don't, I'm going to be one of the 197,000 new people that get put on dialysis every year.
They just built a new dialysis clinic up. They moved the cheap nutrition store and put it in the dialysis.
But it's a big business. You see them everywhere.
Everybody's making money off because we don't know the power that we have.
Right.
So we're constantly creating dis-resonance and dis-ease when it takes a flip of a switch to begin to say, wait a minute. Everything that I have in front of me right now is a manifestation of my conscious and unconscious mind. And my experiences. So let me go in and do a checkup from the neck up, and let me change my thoughts. Let me change my feelings around who first? Myself. Who, by a show of hands, how do I do it? I can do it either way. By a show of hand, who has of someone outside of yourself that you're not in a good relationship with, or you know that you're holding some toxicity towards? You know that you're holding some frustration or bitterness towards? Come on.
No, I don't know about that. Really? No. I'm sure somebody, but I don't have nobody that I like.
I need a person.
Okay, I'll find somebody. I'm holding that can.
They can still irritate you.
They can do what they want.
They can do what they want to do. I'm gonna give you an out. An out. I'm gonna give you an out.
Okay.
That's true. Your father.
No, he passed when I was young. Maybe towards him, but I loved him. That was my closest friend. But I lost him at 16. But we
so how'd you feel after that? Did you feel abandoned?
Yeah, for
okay,
a minute.
Okay, then.
Yeah, so I guess.
Hold that one.
Okay.
Everybody got a person?
Yeah.
Good. How would you get a
person? He stays mad at me, so.
Yeah, I'm working on it now. I got your back.
Oh, that's a good one.
I got your back, Hal. This is a part of one of the whoever this person is. It could be your mother or not. It could be whoever. It's going to be synonymous. I'm getting ready to show you how powerful we are and you are, and we're going to release. An energy. I should have said it should have been an old because I want because of what's happening with this new solar eclipse, a lunar eclipse is getting ready to happen next week. A lot of your stuff is getting ready to be cleared up, stuff that you've been carrying for years, just because of the benevolence of the universe is getting ready to allow Chiron to come and clear some stuff up. So with this eclipse, it's going to be very powerful. Cords will be cut. From attachments, stuff that you felt like you couldn't get rid of. And in this treatment bottle is about 10 different essential oils that all resonate with heart energy. It goes to the heart chakra and it begins to allow it to spin in the proper way. Okay? So what I want to do, I'm going to have you all start taking a couple deep breaths, and I want you to just begin to feel. Deep breathe. This is water that we took all of the imprints off of it, and then I programmed it with fractals, which is sacred geometry, so that it's holding the energy of all of these oils.
Okay, structured water.
Yeah, I restructured it. So, and then there you go. No, this is not Jim Jones for those out there watching.
Hey, look at your next card, but they're already going.
Rub your hands together, cuff your nostrils.
Rub your hands together and what?
Cuff your nostrils.
Cuff your
just
nostrils.
Breathe. Do some diaphragmic breathing. Don't worry about that. The oils are definitely there. It's the energy that we encapsulate here. This is a blend that I use when we're doing our work. Howard, you want to hit the lights for me? And when you can start to feel the energy moving, just raise your hand up for me so I can see. I want to make sure we all are together with this. Some may take a little longer than others, okay? Okay. 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 I'm impressed, but okay. 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 To start to feel the energy in your core and then over around your heart. As you inhale, and exhale.
This is the Black Egg Meditation. Come into a comfortable seated or lying down position and enter into a quiet space. In this meditative space, imagine that you see your own mother standing before you. Allow her to appear to you, maybe as she is now, or as she was when you were a child.